guys, welcome to Kleiner Movie Talk for movie fans. I'm your host, Ashley Mova, and this is The Daily Show, where we give you all the latest news from the world of movies, plus some insight into what it all means. Joining us, as always, is John Campia.
Behold, I have returned. How you doing, everybody? Welcome to the best damn movie-related show on the planet Earth, coming to you from right here at the Kleiner Video Studios here in Burbank, California, and it's really great to be back.
I also hear John Schnepp.
After spending a week in Ellis's trunk, he's decided to listen to our demands. And what's going on?
Also here, Captor Mark Ellis.
That's right. Look, it was a thing. I thought it'd be a funny joke. There's a handle in the trunk you can pull to release it, and he never found it.
First of all, your ridiculous presupposition assumes that Mark Ellis owns a car. That's your first mistake
it's
right there.
A bit of a leap anyway.
He was in Canada. We told you he's in Canada.
All right, let's get started.
All right, it's Monday, which means not only is John released, but it's time for our weekend box office report brought to you by our friends at AMC Theatres. Coming in at number one is the Leonardo DiCaprio film The Revenant, climbing up from the number two position last week, making $16 million. Coming in at number two is Star Wars The Force Awakens with $14.25 million, up one spot from its number three finish last week. In third position is last week's number one film, Ride Along 2, making an additional $12.9 million. And fourth is the new Zac Efron, Robert De Niro film Dirty Grandpa, making $11.5 million. And rounding out the top five is the new horror film The Boy, making $11.26 million on just a $10 million budget. John, what stands out to you about this week's box office report?
A couple things really stand out to me. Number one, can we say that the fifth wave drowned?
No.
Okay, that was a weak way to start off, wasn't it? But yeah, so fifth wave, which did not look good at all. Apparently, everybody else across the nation also kind of agreed that it looked really sad and pathetic and weak. I don't know what Leah, I just have no idea what Leah Schreiber was doing in that movie in the first place. Now, I will confess, been on vacation, did not go to see the film myself, but I had no interest going to see it. So it doesn't surprise me that other people didn't really have a lot of interest in going to see it too. The other thing that stands out to me is this. I think I will officially call it. It's official. It's done. Star Wars, The Force Awakens, as I have said all along, will not catch Avatar to be the number one film. It's now trailing by like $800 million, and it made $14 million this weekend. So that ship has sailed, but that's fine. I'm still going to go see it six or seven more times, so that's all good. Revenant climbing back up to number one. Big snow blizzard on the East Coast. A lot of people felt like they're in the mood to see a snow movie, I guess. So they went to go see Ride Along, and not a movie based in Miami, so they did not go to see Ride Along 2. Other than that, it's a pretty standard fare kind of a rundown, but I did kind of expect... I expected Dirty Grandpa to do a little bit better, not because it's good, because apparently it's not, but because I thought the trailer was great. I thought the trailers for Dirty Grandpa were really funny, and so I was interested in seeing it. I thought more people would be. So, yeah, there's that, and I thought Fifth Wave would do a little bit better as well, but not really all that shocking of a week this week. Schnepp, what do you think?
Yeah, nothing really too shocking. I mean, we're all joking about... You know, what's going to be fourth or fifth, Dirty Grandpa or The Boy? We knew none of those would, like, climb up past, you know, The Revenant or Star Wars or even Ride Along. I'm happy to see Revenant as number one. I mean, just because it makes it not the same. I don't know. It's like, I mean, I thought The Revenant's a really good film, but, you know, I mean, it doesn't really have any competition. There's no one like, we'll take the throne from any of this kind of box office stuff. The Fifth Wave, no one really wanted to see it. Dirty Grandpa, it's one note. I mean, who doesn't like Robert De Niro screwing a bunch of 18-year-olds? I don't know. But once you've seen that, and you're like, are we in Cancun, or what is this? There's a bunch of half-naked people. You know.
It was just last year you and I had that discussion where you said, damn it, what I need more of is Robert De Niro screwing 18-year-olds.
Yeah, 18-year-olds, because sure it was like there was something with him with a 20-year-old. I was like, it's too old.
Too old. Come on, De Niro.
What the hell, De Niro? I want more of that. But with the oil and stuff and the youngsters.
See, I think clearly America wanted Al Pacino screwing 18-year-olds. Yeah. That's what you wanted. I think this weekend means Star Wars is back, ladies and gentlemen. Back from three to number two. It took a week off to say hi to the kids, take care of the old folks, and now it's coming back with a vengeance. I actually subscribe to your weather theory a little bit, that people didn't want to see Dirty Grandpa because it was too warm, Ride Along too, way too warm of a climate. They wanted to see snow, so they saw The Revenant. Star Wars has a lot of snow in it, that's so right. I think that's where it went. You know, The Boy, it just continues this trend of horror movies that are made for nothing and will make their budget back opening weekend. So we're going to keep seeing these movies. Now, I didn't see The Boy. I was not really aware that it was coming out all that much. Didn't even see a trailer for it. So I'm not sure if the movie's good, if it looked good, but people like getting scared in theaters enough so to where you can make these kind of movies and make your budget back. So more power to it. The Fifth Wave I did see, and it's horrendous, so you should not go see it. It's a terrible movie, and it didn't deserve to be in the top five. It didn't even open on that many screens. I think it was under 3,000 screens. Wow. For a movie that you're trying to position as a big-budget Independence Day like Alien Takeover, it didn't have any of that magic.
But yeah. It made 10 times more than Gem and the Holograms, though.
Yes, it did. Yes, it did.
If that's your barometer.
And if that is now your barometer, you are in a rough place. Like, you're in a really rough place. Like, the thing about The Boy was, and once again, I've been on vacation for a while. The only film I went to go see was, I wanted to go see Star Wars with my mom, because my mom's the one who got me turned on to Star Wars. So, yeah. Anyway, but I avoid the rest. The Boy is another one, to me, that looked rather intriguing. I got to confess, I was creeped out by the trailer. Because if you read the synopsis of it, it seems absolutely bloody ridiculous. But for whatever reason, the trailer for me worked, and I was curious. And it's nice to see, like, horror project like that on $10 million budget can come out on opening weekend and make $11 million. Mm-hmm. That's got to be encouraging for them.
Speaking of horror, Zac Efron just cannot get a movie to open well. I mean, you talk about how you thought Dirty Grandpa would do better. I'm surprised it did $11 million because since we saw here at the Collider Studios, we watched that trailer the day it came out and we were all laughing.
Sure.
And then by
laughing
the end of the trailer, it was running out of steam by the end of the trailer.
Sure.
Since that trailer hit, we've seen less and less and less. It really felt like the studio was trying to hide that movie from us after that opening trailer, and so I was shocked to see it on the top five anywhere.
All right, what's next?
Last night, the Producers Guild of America held its annual awards ceremony in Los Angeles and surprised many people by naming The Big Short as their outstanding produced feature film of the year. The award was accepted by the film's producers Brad Pitt, Dede Gardner, and Jeremy Kleiner. The PGA Awards is considered by many industry experts to be a major indicator as to what could win the Oscar. Mark, were you surprised by The Big Short winning the PGA award, and how does it affect your outlook on the Oscar race?
Well, look, I don't know who Brad Pitt's date was, but that was a far drop off from Angelina Jolie. It's a very different kind of kiss you're getting. Yeah, I think everybody's surprised that The Big Short won. I might not go so far as to say shocked, because I thought The Big Short was great, and it was in my top 10 movies of the year. It wasn't quite as good as Spotlight, in my opinion, and it seems like Spotlight had all the momentum going for it as far as awards go, and so now all of a sudden, with The Big Short, Adam McKay getting nominated for an Oscar for that movie, it looks like The Big Short could be one of these movies that just at the last minute, it sneaks a length ahead of its competition and maybe does something really shocking at the next awards ceremony.
See, I am shocked, but not because I didn't think The Big Short was a quality film. It's a great movie. It's a really, really good movie, deserves its nominations, all that kind of stuff. But when you look at the momentum, you know, from all the various, whether it's the LA Film Critics, New York Film Critics, Golden Globes, whatever, you look at the momentum seems to have suggested it's Spotlight and it's The Revenant. And that's mm-hmm. the two-horse race. That's what it's felt like. And I had a buddy of mine who's an awards journalist, and he was at the PGA's last, and he wrote, shock. He said the whole place, like, it's almost like the entire ballroom almost like did a double take and say, wait a minute, what did he say? Did he say The Big Short? Now, the PGA is the one major awards body that actually uses the same voting system called the preferential ballot, I believe is the name of the system. It's the same voting system that the Academy uses for theirs. So all that combined, the fact that these films have lined up Best Picture at the Oscars ends up being the Best Picture at the PGAs, the fact that they use the same voting system, this is the results. This now has a lot of people second guessing. We could be heading into, I think a lot of us felt Birdman was probably going to win with about 13 years. What is it? About a boy? About mm-hmm. a boy. About a 13-year-old boy that it had an outside dark horse shot. But
Boyhood.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. About a 13-year-old boyhood where.
That sounds creepier.
About the Where's boy.
Robert
it's a horror movie.
Where's Robert De Niro?
Yeah. I'm in a horror movie with this kid, Kindling. Ah.
So,
that doesn't even sound like Robert De Niro.
But now this is starting to feel like. This is one of those years. This could be anybody's. Like, I would have put above The Big Short. I would have thought Spotlight had a better chance. I would have thought Revenant had a better chance. I would have thought The Martian had a better chance. And now, I don't know. This is a year I'm not going to be putting money down on anything. Andy Schnapp, how do you see this?
Well, we all know The Martian is a comedy, according to the Golden Globes, so it couldn't possibly. The Big Short was a surprise for me. I definitely. In my eyes, Spotlight was the one that seemed naturally headed towards getting an Oscar out of all the films that were nominated. The Big Short is definitely informative. It has a very chaotic, interesting, cool way that they that Adam decided to make the film. McKay, I think that's McKay making out with Brad Pitt. I'm pretty sure that's him. Isn't that that picture right there?
Oh, I can't tell. I don't see McKay from that angle.
Yeah, I've seen McKay from way too many angles, and I think that's McKay sucking face with Pitt. I'd love to see him win, if only for anything to shake it up a little bit after Chris Rock completely devastates everyone and people are running away screaming.
I mean, I'm looking
crying.
More forward to Chris Rock's opening monologue than anything else at the Oscars. Yeah. But when you look at this win, do you guys think that The Big Short was, Spotlight was so much better than The Big Short? Because as I'm thinking about my list right now, my top 10, I had one of them at 8 and one was 7. I got college drunk this weekend, so I'm having a little bit of trouble remembering everything. But I don't know which one I had ahead of the other one, because I think they're that close as far as film quality goes.
Well, that's what happens when you hang out with Robert De Niro for a weekend out of town. But I think, to me, it's Head and Shoulders. It was Spotlight. To me, Head and Shoulders. But I did like The Big Short so much that I can totally see other people looking at it a little bit differently. It's just, once again, for me, it's not a matter of, because I think Spotlight is so much better than that, it's been about an issue of momentum that we've seen the patterns starting to form, and now the PGA's come along and it totally shatters the patterns. And now we're heading into the Oscar season. I'm like, now I have no idea.
Yeah, I thought the Spotlight is just, as far as a film is constructed, in my eyes, it's one of the best films of the year. Not just better than Big Short, but of all the whole year. I thought that movie meant a lot to see that kind of that story come out the way it was told, the way they showed the Spotlight news team. Everything about it was emotional and it had an impact on me. So I mean,
written impeccably, directed impeccably, acted impeccably. Yeah, it's just, it kind of chalked off the whole list. All right, folks, we've reached that part of the show now for buy or sell. Here's how this works. In front of her, Ashley's got a few other items in the world of movie news. She's going to run them down. Then those of us at the table are simply going to say whether we buy it or sell it. So, Ashley, what do we got?
Well, speaking of the Oscars, the Academy has just announced sweeping changes in its membership process with the goal of doubling both its female and minority membership within the next 4 years. The announcement was released by the Academy President Cheryl Boone Isaacs, herself an African-American woman, which said the following. Beginning later this year, each new member's voting status will last 10 years and will be renewed if that new member has been active in motion pictures during that decade. In addition, members will receive lifetime voting rights after 3 10-year terms or if they have won or been nominated for an Academy Award. We will apply these same standards retroactively to current members. In other words, if a current member has not been active in the last 10 years, they can still qualify by meeting the other criteria. Those who do not qualify for active status will be moved to the emeritus status. Emeritus members do not pay dues but enjoy all the privileges of membership except voting. This will not affect voting for this year's Oscars. At the same time, the Academy will supplement the traditional process in which current members sponsor new members by launching an ambitious global campaign to identify and recruit qualified new members who represent greater diversity. In order to immediately increase diversity on the Board of Governors, the Academy will establish 3 new governor's seats that will be nominated by the president for 3-year terms and confirmed by the board. Schnett, buy or sell these new changes being implemented by the Academy?
I buy them. You know, like in our pre-production meeting, I just threw it out and was like, hey, let's like talk this through. I want to really understand this. We kind of all talked it through on layman's terms. And I
how
really...
many 18-year-olds will be on the board of governors?
If it's up to me, hey, nobody's doing a good De Niro impression today, by the way. But we're all trying for you, the home viewer. I think actually my voice with your look.
I was squeezing a bunch of oil.
This oil's no good.
Hey, you are. Horrible De Niro. This week on Horrible De Niro. Hey, hello. I love Robert De Niro.
Hey, my Pacino is pretty stinky too.
Hey, that's not. Who is that? Hey, the Oscars. Hey, let's get serious, guys. I think this is a really good move for the Academy to do this, and it makes a lot of sense. It takes out what we've all been reading about, which is like, you know, the majority is like, you know, how old are they? 63-year-old white males, I believe. That's the
average.
Average majority. So I think by taking out people who are inactive and haven't been actually making films, you know, for the last 10 years, they lose their voting privileges. And I also think by bringing some more people of diversity in right now to get the ball rolling as soon as possible is better. Better late than never. So I think it's a all these things are good, even though they won't have any effect on this year's Oscars. It sounds like by doing these motions of A, getting rid of people who aren't active, and B, you know, actively promoting and getting women and minorities in there, I think it's a good thing.
I'm very curious as to what that one paragraph was about, where it's you can recruit new members and it helps promote greater diversity. Exactly how does that process take place? What is the recruitment like? What is the huge international campaign you have to launch? I think this is all very exciting overall. The issue that I have with it is how much change can it actually affect when you're changing the voting board, but if you're not making sweeping changes in how movies get made, then there's still you have to pick from the same pool of movies that you get every year. Now, maybe something like a deserving movie like Straight Outta Compton or Dope or something that featured minorities prominently might get more recognition this way, but you still have to have more involvement of minorities in making movies in order to make real change when you're talking about voting on those very movies that come out every year. But this is a pretty good place to start, and it was a necessary change for the Oscars to make. I'm surprised it's happening as quickly as it was, because it was just last week on this show we were talking about all these boycotts that might be happening this year. So for the president to step up and say, we're doing these changes and we're doing them effective pretty much immediately or for next year, I think that's pretty impressive.
Yeah, I look, I've been on record. I've done this on my personal channel. I've done it here on the show. Look, the Academy Awards this year, the nominees were right. They got him right. Will Smith didn't deserve to be nominated above the five guys who got nominated. Michael B. Jordan, who was great in Creed, you've heard me talk about how much I like him in Creed. On my list, he did not deserve to be in that top five. The other five performances were better than his. That's just the way it was, and that's the way it worked out. I don't think if all those sweeping changes to the Academy that they're talking about, the Cheryl Isaacs, who is an amazingly smart woman, by the way, all these sweeping changes she's talking about, had that been in place last year, I don't think the nominees list this year would have been any different, because it goes to your point where you're saying exactly, it still would have been the same movies, the same actors, the same people there. This move does not fix Hollywood. And there's an issue in Hollywood. I've gone on record before. I don't think this Oscar's so white. I think that's completely misplaced outrage. I think the real issue here is the larger machine of Hollywood, which you're talking about. Look, because here's the problem. I think that these changes are awesome. The Academy Awards, especially since, you know, movies, and one of the greatest things about movies is that they have universal appeal. You know, somebody in Venezuela can be watching the same movie I'm watching today, is the same movie that somebody in China is watching. I mean, that's something amazing. Movies can unify people in such a way that nothing else ever can. And if you're going to have a body kind of be the representative of the excellence in that art, being the Academy of Motion Pictures Arts and Sciences, then that body, I think, needs to be a little bit more reflective of the cultures that together watch and love the movies. These changes are overdue. These changes are absolutely needed. I love that they're doing this. And I also love that they're not trying to fix it all in one day. Because if you try to fix everything in one day, you end up kind of mucking everything up and just making it worse. They announced very simple play as a start. Within the first 4 years, we're going to double the amount of minorities. We're going to double the amount of women on this board. And I think that was the great plan. But I guarantee you in 2020, once they've doubled the number of minorities and doubled the amount of women on there, they're not stopping. I guarantee you after 2020, they're going to push it even a little bit further. But they're taking it in small steps. And that's the right way to fix it. This is a great move for them to take. Again, I don't think it would have changed the outcome of this year's Oscars, nor do I think it would have changed the outcome of last year's Oscars. But I do think as a body, it is incumbent upon them to be a little bit more reflective of the movie-going audience. This doesn't fix it, but it puts it as a step in the right direction.
You know, I disagree only because I think when you look at the majority of people being 63-year-old white males, and, you know, I'm not 63. I am a white male. But I thought Tom Hardy's performance in The Revenant was great, but I thought Idris Elba's performance in Beasts of No Nation was far superior.
And I didn't.
But I'm just saying, I've talked with many people who are like, when you're looking through, like, people of different races and minorities and all these, you're like, well, it wasn't like you had, it was slim pickings. There was a lot of different people who, like, could have been nominated that just weren't. So, I mean, like, you say no, I say yes. I just think that getting a more diverse group of people in there who have voting powers, those kinds of things will be, you know, rise to the surface.
But you and I both agree, we talked about this before, when you and I both agreed like a long time ago that we always thought that the big problem Beasts of No Nation was going to run into was not an anti-racial diversity thing. It was an anti-Netflix thing.
Correct.
We always kind of thought it was going to run into problems as far
I agree. I mean, but I was like looking at all the performances, and I definitely think out of all the performances of this last year, Idris was one of the ones that stuck out to me.
I mean, you also have to see the movies. That's the thing that this is going to do immediately is because when we were talking about it before, I compared it, as I usually do, to sports. It's like the Masters golf tournament where you have to play well in the Masters to get invited back to the Masters every year. If you won the Masters in 1975, they'll let you tee off and have an honorary, hey, I'm still alive, I hit a ball 100 yards down. Now let's let the real competitors, the real people who care about winning this tournament play. It's the same thing with the Oscars now, and I think it's a great change. These people, they're going to be younger, they're going to be more conscious of actually seeing the movies and giving everything a fair shot before they make their nominations.
Yeah, now it's this thing still won't fix the problem in Hollywood as a whole, where more minorities need more significant roles written for them and awarded to them on different levels. This doesn't fix that. That's still a problem that needs to be addressed. But this is absolutely a step in the right direction. I think I speak for all of us when we say we applaud it. All right, what's next?
During the NFL playoffs yesterday, Warner Brothers released a new TV spot for the upcoming Batman versus Superman, one of which gave us a fuller version of Bruce Wayne's conversation with Alfred regarding Superman bringing the war to us. John Byers, sell this new Batman versus Superman TV spot.
Cannot buy it enough. I'm watching the football games yesterday, and the first spot they show is the new Superman one. Didn't really show us much that we hadn't seen before, except for him saying the press need to do the right thing. And that puts then Perry White's comments in context when he goes, it's not your, you don't get to decide what the right thing is. Little does he know he's actually saying that to Superman. And the message is even more poignant because that's a lesson Superman's probably trying to learn at that point. So I thought that was good. And then later, when the Batman one comes on, I freaked the hell out. For when he's, that line was such a Batman thing to say. Like, thousands died. How many next time? Millions? If we believe there is even a 1% chance that he could be our enemy, then we have to take it as an absolute certainty and we must destroy it. Like, I'm freaking out. I'm sitting on this couch. I was at my buddy's place watching a football game, and I am losing my mind. And seeing Affleck play it, and Affleck play it to, I'll say it, perfection. Boom, there it is. He played that part to perfection. He could have overhammed that line so easily. He didn't, though. He could have undersold it, made it too subtle. He didn't. He hit it with the intensity that it needed, that we've seen him doing all these other things. And I put on my Twitter yesterday, you hear them quick crickets? That's all those people that were laughing when they announced Ben Affleck as Batman. And they're all gone underground now. He looks spectacular in this. I cannot wait to see him play Batman. This spot was great. And I'm not big on 30-second spots. I will very rarely talk about 30-second TV spots. I like talking about the two-minute trailers, like the full stuff. But I like I said, I just freaking lost my mind when I saw this. Anyway, Mark, you saw it. What did you think?
Oh, yeah. And I love the order of the trailer, like you alluded to. So we saw the Superman one first. And I'm a Batman guy. Like, I'm rooting for Batman. If he's fighting anybody, I'm pulling for Batman. I think Superman would win in round one. But I want Batman to win. So the first ad you see was Superman heavy. And it's Superman talking a lot of trash to Batman. And then the spot ends. I'm like, well, they didn't really give Batman a fair shake. When do we get to see Batman's version of it? Then this one comes out. And then we go back to the game at the same time in the game, when the Broncos D is probably saying, if there's a 1% chance that Rob Gronkowski's an alien, we have to take it as an absolute certainty. I thought it played so well on TV. I think it gets what these spots are doing is it's building awareness for people, not like us, for other people who weren't aware that Batman versus Superman was the movie that's coming out now in a tantalizing month and a half. It is just so exciting that they're doing these spots right. Now look, in the back of our head, we all know that this fight eventually is going to end and it's going to be the dawn of the Justice League, and that's all well and good. But what a spot like this does, it pushes all that stuff into the back of my mind, and it prepares me for us to see a movie where the majority of that film is going to be one of the most epic clashes. It's the Brady versus Manning of the superhero world.
Yeah, this spot, Batfleck, anybody who had issues with him playing Batman, it should have been erased after they finally saw how he's portraying Bruce Wayne. I mean, we've gotten little clips of it from the trailers, but this is like a nice full scene with him talking to Alfred, and it was really well played. I'm really excited about this film, but I have to be honest, even after that trailer was over, I heard, is she with you? I thought she was with you. And I was like, no! Why did they have to show that? It cannot get undone. But But they're doing the best that they can do to make you forget about that. And they, we all know that's happening. That's going to happen at the end. Is she with you? It's, hey, but I thought it's Batman versus Superman. I thought she was with you.
Not even the movie now. They edited it out of the movie.
That would be amazing if they cut it out. Please cut it out. Cut it out. Cut that scene out. That would be awesome. Or when we see it in context, we'll all be like, it's awesome. But seeing it out of context and it's called Batman v Superman, it's still hard for me to forget it. But at least these spots are making me forget it. That last 30-second trailer with them fighting. I think that's really what the key is like making us believe that there is an issue between Batman and Superman. And it is going to come down to them having to find some common ground to unite about. So that spot was great.
And what this spot also did for me is it showed that there's a new legit contender to the celebrated crown of Alfred. Because Michael, I love Michael Gough. I love Michael Caine. Jeremy Irons is going to be right there with the best Alfreds of all time.
Totally. Yeah, that looks great. And one of the things, it really feels to me like Warner Brothers was listening to all the criticism they got when they dropped that, what we call the second trailer. Right. With the reveal, and it took away the focus of the Batman v Superman, because all three or four things we've seen come out since then have been squarely focused on the Batman v Superman part,
right,
and just letting us get to the end of the movie to see the Dawn of Justice part. What I thought was really interesting too was that in these two spots, you were mentioning this, and I think you were bang on in your analysis. You're saying these spots are really revealing things to the non-hardcore fans. Because what these two spots did for me was they clearly laid out in the Superman spot, here's the problem Superman's got with Batman. He's a vigilante. Civil rights are being trampled on. This is not right. The press is, we got to do this. And so now we understand Superman's motivation a bit. Then the focus went to Bruce Wayne. Now we fully understand why Bruce Wayne has this hate on for Superman, why he's so hell-bent on getting rid of Superman, because he could spend the end of humanity. He's holding responsible for the death of thousands, maybe millions, and even if it's only probable that he's a good guy, not good enough, according to Batman. I love that. They did so much right with these spots that it just upped my... It did make me forget about trailer number two.
Right on.
But thank you for reminding me about it.
Is she with you, Ellis?
I thought she was with you.
What?
That's my De Niro saying that.
And all that being said, let's put that big disclaimer out there again. This movie could suck. We're not saying the movie is awesome. We're just saying that the spots are awesome, and it certainly gives me hope. So let's hold out that hope at least for a little while longer. All right, what's next?
On the heels of the sad passing of David Bowie, The Hollywood Reporter has revealed that TriStar Pictures has had a Labyrinth reboot in the works for a while. According to the report, Guardians of the Galaxy co-writer Nicole Perlman has been brought on board to supply the screenplay. There is no definitive information if the new project would be a true reboot or some form of sequel. Mark, would you buy or sell a new Labyrinth movie at this point?
You know, I think I would. I kind of tossed and turned over this for a while because Labyrinth is such a special movie to me. I watched it over and over and over when I was a kid. And if you had asked me this even, you know, 3-4 years ago, I would have been like, I don't think you can touch that property. The reason why I think I'm changing it enough to where I can buy the announcement if we get one of a Labyrinth reboot or a sequel or whatever is... A lot of it helps from Star Wars is that the going back to practical effects for movies, if you do Labyrinth again, you have to do it like you did the first Labyrinth. Sure, you're going to throw some CGI shots in there. We understand that. But to see all those Muppets hanging out together, it meant so much to me and it felt so realistic. I loved watching that element of it. David Bowie as the Goblin King is impossible to replace like that. I mean, you're talking about trying to replace Robin Williams in Aladdin or something on that level, at least in my mind. So don't try to outdo what Bowie did. You're not going to be able to do it. Do a different spin on what the Goblin King or what a group of goblins would look like, and I think that you can have a Labyrinth movie that even the hardcore fans of the original one would appreciate.
You know, Nicole Perlman, the writer from Guardians who's been working on the script for this, she came out and she addressed a couple of these things. Now, there were some people, understandably so, who were very upset when they heard about Labyrinth getting another movie coming out, because a lot of people were very upset that they thought it felt like the studios were just trying to take advantage and capitalize on the death of David Bowie. But Nicole, the writer, came out and she specified, as we suspected, no. I've been on this project for 2 years now or for a while. This is a project that's already been in the works for years. And remember, TriStar didn't come out and make a press announcement. This was the Hollywood Reporter that uncovered it and decided to report it. So nobody was trying to take advantage of the passing of David Bowie. Now, the other thing that Perlman said that I thought was interesting was that she seemed to suggest that it's actually going to be more of a continuation of the story. Mm. It's more going to be a part two rather than a reboot. I think that's going to make a lot of people happy when they hear about that. I think it's time to revisit this world. I do. I think this is a great idea. I think it's time to visit the world. I think you got a great screenwriter on there. Let's hold our breath a little bit and see who they bring on as a director. But I think this is good news, and I'm looking forward to it. Jeanette?
Well, I'd like to make sure that the Henson Group, the Henson Company, is back.
And was it not Jim Henson's final project that he worked on? Yeah, that's right.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's like Brian Henson worked on it, his son, everybody worked on it. And it's like one of those things where, you know, if they're not involved, it's sort of like it would be like making The Dark Crystal Returns without the Henson Company being involved. I mean, that's kind of how I feel about it. So and you're right. I mean, it's been in process just like the Dark Crystal has been, like, for years. They've been trying to make a sequel. They've been trying to make a reboot or something. They've been trying to do something with it. And unfortunately, just timed out with the passing of David Bowie. So.
Yeah, like, I know you and I have both had the privilege of being at Henson Studios before fairly recently to walk around that place. And, like, I love the Muppets. I love Kermit and Piggy and all them. But seeing a couple of the creatures from Labyrinth hanging around, it's like you just get this really cool feeling. And I just had a thought, and I don't know if it's the worst idea I've ever had or the best idea. Okay, so look, I wouldn't want to be the guy that says, okay, we need a bad guy and he needs to replace David Bowie. Let's get a rock star. But.
Steven Tyler.
Mick Jagger.
Oh,
Mick
yeah.
Jagger is not the worst actor in the world. He's played a bad guy before. Yeah, it was Free Jack, but he's also been in other stuff. But Steven Tyler's also, does he not look like a goblin? I mean.
Well, and Mick Jagger was friends with David Bowie, so that'd be also kind of cool.
If Mick Jagger does like a version of Rebel that they somehow throw in there, it'd be sweet.
Speaking of those puppets, there was an awards ceremony we were at last year, and they had a full life-size Sketsy costume. Remember that? Mm-hmm. I lost my mind because I'm a huge fan of the Dark Labyrinth. There's a
the fusion of both worlds,
the Henson cinematic universe
with De Niro in there. Henson, where am I?
All right, folks, we reached that part of the show now for mailbag. Listen, if you've got a topic or a question you'd like us to address on the show, you can email us anytime at collidervideo@gmail.com. Now, as we're doing this show live, there are thousands of you watching us live right now. We're going to save a little bit of time at the end of the show, take some of your live questions, and you can get your live questions to us by hopping on Twitter and tweeting to us at Kleiner Video. Make sure you're following us at Kleiner Video as well. But for now, let's get to the mailbag. Ashley, what do we got?
Hossein J. Shishtari writes, big fan of the show and the entire crew. My question is, why do TV directors get overshadowed by the show's writers? And the opposite happens in movies where the writers don't get that recognition that film directors get.
The fundamental difference between a television show and a movie is this, though. The movie is one story, one project, shot once, and the director comes in and oversees all of that. The writers write the script, and then the director takes that and goes. With the television series, though, quite often you'll get, like, most television shows don't have one director. They have a director comes in for one episode, then another director comes in for the next episode, another director comes in the next episode. So a director has no real control over where this story goes or what's going to happen. All they can do is direct this one episode. Who is constant and continuous and developing the whole story of a TV show? That's the writers. That's the showrunners. Those are the people who actually control the overall scope of the show. So that's why in movies, it's the director who's really the main guy, the one who steers the ship the most. In television, it's really the writers. Schnepp is a guy who's worked in both worlds. How would you explain it?
Yeah, it's just as you did explain it. I mean, but writers, ultimately, it's the showrunner or the creator of the show if they stay around and they oversee, like, episodes 1 through 10. They create the story arcs. They assign the different writers to the stories, and the directors are all assigned to those stories as well. With a movie, it is like you're steering the ship. You're in control of the beginning, middle, and end, the tone of it. I mean, in directing a TV show, you're also in charge of the tone of what episode you're directing, and if you have to fit into something that's already established, usually you have to, you know, watch a bunch of the other episodes to make sure you're not getting crazy and be like, hey, I'm doing all these weird wide shots or whatever. You want to make it somewhat consistent. It's not about, like, putting your stamp on it. Well, with myself, like a show like Metalocalypse, I was able to put my stamp on it because I directed most of the episodes, so other directors kind of followed what I had already done or did, like, mimic certain shots or ways I would open shows or things like that. So sometimes if you're working on a show in television and you're the director and you're on it for a long time, then you and the writers have kind of established a tone and a look of something. So it can work both ways most of the time, but it is, TV is a writer's medium, film is a director's medium because of those.
Metalocalypse kicked ass, by the way.
Thank you.
It really, if you haven't seen Metalocalypse, check it out. And a lot of times you see big-time film directors and they come from the TV world because that's where they get their chops a little bit. And it's nice to see them get recognition and opportunities based off the work they did off TV. I mean, look at a guy like Rian Johnson or a guy like J.J. Abrams, where a lot of the earlier things they did in their career were based in the TV world. And so you learn how you're, that's how you cut your teeth. And then when you want to have more creative control over a project that you're interested in, like for those guys, Star Wars, it's like now you have a more padded resume to where people will trust you with a bigger property.
All right, what's next?
Alex Gable writes, since Game of Thrones will eventually come to an end, a lot has been said about ending the series with one or more feature-length films. Do you like this idea? And if this were to be the case, how well do you think it will perform at the box office, given its worldwide success on the small screen?
It's really tough to say, because sometimes, oftentimes, you'll bring a very popular TV property to the big screen, and it does not perform all that well. Entourage is a great example. Entourage had a lot of viewers and a lot of followers, did not translate into box office success. Most of them don't. Here's the thing, though. I've always thought that a Game of Thrones one could be interesting. First of all, the challenge is this, is at the rate Game of Thrones kills off key characters, I don't know what characters you're still going to have around right. to make a feature film based on that's going to attract in the standard viewers. But I've always kind of felt, even though I'm the anti-prequel guy, I'm the type of guy that I've always said that they've talked a lot about, you know, 1,000 years ago when the kings had dragons and all that kind of stuff. I've always thought you could tell really interesting backstories in a feature-length film. I always thought that would be a good medium for it. It would be a feature film. How well would it do? Hard to say. They did a little experiment where they did, like they showed the last two episodes of a previous season on IMAX. And I think it did reasonably okay, but it's not like they were packing out the houses or anything like that. So it's tough to say. I think if you did a Game of Thrones movie for $100 million, I think if you did a Game of Thrones movie for $100 million, I think you could be, it would be reasonable for you to expect that you'd make enough money to break even and make a little profit. Once you get in that $150, $200, $225 million range, that now you're talking about a movie that needs to make $500 million worldwide, and I'm not sure it would do that. Mark, or Christian?
Ah, 0 for 2.
Ashley.
Yes? Yes.
All right, so.
How do you see it?
What I think with Game of Thrones here, I'm going into my WC Fields. Hey, kids, what's going on? You eating your carrots? Hey. So,
eating your carrots?
What is this whole Game of Thrones thing anyway? I'm from the 20s.
I think Game of Thrones as a movie, I went and saw that double feature, and I swear to God, I enjoyed it so much. I was like, I think this is better than any movie that's playing in the theater at the time. When I went and saw that doubleheader of the two last episodes of Game of Thrones.
To be fair, you saw it when Jupiter Ascending.
Hey,
and,
look,
Seventh,
you know, I'm
Sun
not,
was
I'm not
out.
Saying what else was playing. I'm just saying that this was better. So I think for me, I would love to see them do it again with this sixth season. I would love to. Hey, take those last two episodes, throw them in the theater. You got me. I'm paying for it. I don't have that AMC card anymore, yo. I'm paying for that. Double bill. What's happening?
I want them to do it differently, though. I don't want them to show me the last two episodes from last season. What I want them to do is I want them to release the first episode of the new season 1 week early in theaters only.
I'm 100%
of
that.
Pack that house.
Yeah, just make it a 90-minute special. Or they could do the last episode 1 week early and just make it a 90-minute freak fest. People freak out. That they've already got it in the can. Man, they're just counting money. They're printing money right now.
People would
HBO. We're just giving
riot
you money
in the streets yeah. if you didn't get a chance to see it opening weekend, because you know the whatever whoever dies, whatever plot twist is going to be all over Twitter.
Right.
And people are going
right.
to hate.
That's
for
why
it.
You got to do it with the first episode of the season and not the last episode of the season.
It makes
not,
sense.
Not as spoiler heavy.
And I think it would crush. And I think that a Game of Thrones movie would crush. Yeah. I think you can do tons of these. I think what you can do is you can end the TV run and then do Game of Thrones anthology films, where it's not necessarily we have to stick to one time period. We can go back 1,000 years and do a movie. We can go back. We can go 5 years in the future from the end of the TV show and do a movie. I think there's a big enough fan base with Game of Thrones. They've seen what they can do with the production values on HBO. Mm. Imagine what it'll look like on the big screen. The big challenge you have is, can you tell a story that for the fans feels expansive and rich and in-depth enough in a time frame that's only 2, maybe 2.5 hours. I think you can pull it off, and I want to see him try, because Game of Thrones is something that it's such a great, vast universe. You don't want it to end in two more seasons.
What about if they did a movie in between seasons 6 and 7, where they're like, look, we're gonna incorporate some of these storylines from offshoot, where it doesn't, like, you could watch season 6 and 7 and not see this movie. and you would miss out on a little bit. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah, that's a it's precarious, but you could do it. You just have to be very, very careful that it doesn't become, hey, if you're a fan of Game of Thrones, for you to understand what's going to happen in season 8, you got to watch this movie first, because then you're going to alienate people. But if you can do what you were explaining, which is find a way that integrates it into the Game of Thrones world and put in that timeline, but if you don't go out to see the movie, you're fine just watching the TV show. That could be
it. But also, either way, just don't waste your time. Don't twiddle your thumbs like what you did with Entourage or what. Like the X-Files came back last night, and I liked watching the X-Files on TV. The first X-Files movie did very, very well because it was building fresh off the momentum of the TV show. Then they made the next X-Files movies like 10 years later, and nobody wanted to see it because they're like, oh, they're still alive? Really?
Why are they hunting the werewolves? I thought they were dealing with aliens.
Yeah, it's just make Game of Thrones soon.
All right, last mailbag question.
Jason Martinez writes, hey everyone, my name is Jason. Started watching the show 4 months ago thanks to running into a random Jedi Council episode on YouTube. Woo-hoo. But I'm emailing you today about Doctor Strange and the great potential it has. To me, they have a phenomenal cast for the film so far from the cast we know of, but just seems like Marvel didn't get the right director or group of writers for the film. Most have all worked on the same movies that weren't all that good, so I was just wondering how y'all felt about this.
I think they got the perfect director for it. I'll be honest with you. Scott Derrickson. I think this guy knows how to leverage mood. He knows how to leverage atmosphere. He knows how to elicit that odd and eerie kind of creepiness. And that is something that lately, especially, not just lately, but all time, has not been a part of the Marvel Cinematic Universe on that level. You need to bring in somebody with horror sensibilities to do that. And if you've seen The Exorcism of Emily Rose, you know he can deliver, and he can deliver well. Look, the first Sinister film, that was a film that before the third act, which kind of unraveled, I think that was script issues, but that first two acts I thought was creepy and tense, and they did it really, really well. And he did it kind of within a PG-13 kind of framework, which you also got to be able to do with Doctor Strange. So I'm telling you, me personally, I think it was the right choice working with a guy like Kevin Feige, because who would have thought Peyton Reed for Ant-Man? Who would have thought the Russo brothers for Captain America, Winter Soldier? Mm-hmm. But they were the guys bringing the right sensibilities that working in conjunction with a Kevin Feige could really bring that out and nail it. And I think Scott Derrickson's the right guy for it. Anyway, Schnepp, your thoughts on that?
I agree. I think it's seeing the possibilities within the talent inherent within the writers or directors. It's not necessarily the guy who wrote Sinister is the same guy. The writer-director team of Sinister are the guys who are doing Doctor Strange, and I think they did a great job, especially with the first two-thirds of Sinister. I agree. You know, those guys are nerds, and I think when they, you know, it's not like Kevin Feige just picked those two randomly. There's a whole bunch of other people who are going for the job. He's meeting with a ton of different people. Something about that team, when they came in and they had a sweaty love for Doctor Strange, I'm sure they sold him on the ability of, like, we could do this, and I want to, this is how I'd play this. You're pitching the producer when you're going in for a job as a director. That's how it works. You're like, because they're like, look, I saw 10 other people who are in your same category. What are you going to do different? What would you bring to the character? Why should I hire you? And you're basically like, I'm batting. Here I go. Kunk. Those guys hit a home run with Kevin Feige. That's why they got a cast. Just like you see the cast is cast, where like Benedict Cumberbatch, the whole cast is incredible, all the way down to Mads Mikkelsen. I think he probably did the right thing with casting these guys as the writer and director. I think they knew the Doctor Strange character. They're going to bring that element that he was looking for, something that was in the horror realm, but also something that can transform past the horror realm and be like not just a superhero film, but a horror film as well. So I think it's a good cast.
And a little bit of self-correction here. Sinister, the original Sinister, was indeed rated R. Mm-hmm. So I said it was rated PG. Rated R. Felt like it could have been rated PG-13, though, when I really think about it.
Yeah, until the end, when it was just, you know, the crow's unemployed brother sneaking in and, you know, hanging out with kids. Oh, like Robert De Niro probably would. But look, you got to remember, too, once those guys went in with a pitch and once they got the job, it's not like you're just sending them off to an island and being like, all right, go cook up your story. They're working within the structure and the framework of the Marvel story group, and so it's a sharing collective of ideas that very rarely has missed. I mean, I didn't love the end of Iron Man 3. Iron Man 2 is kind of a mess. Other than those, they do everything very, very well, and it's a nice way to bounce ideas off each other. Scott Derrickson is a guy who can affect your mood emotionally when you're seeing a movie, and that that works so well with a horror film. I'm with you guys. I loved, especially the two, the first two thirds of Sinister. And if you can build up that mood, and then you have all this power from Marvel coming at you the last third of the movie, I think it's one of my most anticipated of the year. Mm-hmm. I cannot wait to see what they do with Doctor Strange. It's going to feel like a Marvel movie, and at the same time, feel totally new from all the stuff we've already seen.
All right, folks, so I said we would take a little bit of time to take some of your live Twitter questions, and we're going to do that right now. Hop on Twitter, tweet to us, at Collider Video. Ashley's been picking some out, so Ashley, what have you picked out from the Twitter sphere today?
The first one comes from Sexy Beastmaster.
Yes.
Mom, get off Twitter.
And they write, will they have the guts to kill off Cap in Civil War like in the comic books?
No, and it would be stupid for them to do it. It would be stupid for them to kill him off. Because we already know Chris Evans is coming back for Infinity War Part 1 and Part 2. He's already booked off his time, shooting like 9 months on that. So he's in the entire thing. So it's not just going to be at the end. He's coming back to life. And it would be Marvel. I said this before. It would be Marvel, once again, one of the big weaknesses of Marvel films. And everybody knows I'm a huge fan of the Marvel films so far. But one of the big weaknesses that they have is they've gone way too many times to the well of, oh, this character is dead. Aha, he's not dead. Oh, he's dead. No, he's not dead. Oh, Thor just got killed. But wait, no, he's alive. Oh, Loki got killed. No, he's alive. Wait, Loki got killed again. No, he's alive. Oh, Samuel Jackson's character, Nick Fury. Nick Fury is dead. Oh, no, he comes back at the end of the movie. Every freaking buddy dies and comes back. And if they do it again, it would be idiotic. Oh, they're flat out idiotic of them to do it. So when you say, will they have the guts to do it? That kind of suggests like it would be a good thing to do. No, it would be a stupid thing to do. So I really don't think they're going to do it for those reasons. But Mark, anyway, do you think they will kill off Captain America in Civil War?
Well, as a sexy beast myself, I don't want to argue with my master too much. Yeah, he's the guy that I report to. But in my sexy beast adventures around the world, I don't think you kill off Cap in this movie, though, Mr. Beastmaster. I just don't think it makes a lot of sense. Especially when you can have such an emotional arc if you do kill him off in Infinity War 1 or 2.
That's a different story.
You might see a lot of Marvel characters die. He's such a big selling point for Marvel right now that I don't know who would... You know, you also think about it this way. Who in the movie version of Civil War would be the one that does kill Captain America? And so now we not only are down a huge main character, but now we also, it's like, do we even want to hang out with Tony Stark anymore after he took the life of Captain America? Whoever ends up killing him, it would just feel kind of icky and a hard thing to patch up. That I think you probably save something like that, a huge play like that, I think you save it for Infinity War, probably Part 2.
I think they're going to kill Cap. I think Cap goes out in Civil War, but... and they announced that he's going to be, you know, in Infinity War. They announce it. That doesn't necessarily mean it's true. They've lied to us constantly. Yeah. In Dark Knight, they're like, I'm not Ra's al Ghul's daughter. Oh, by the way, I am in the movie. I lied to you. They lie to you all the time. That's part of the magic of movies. They shouldn't be telling us the truth, especially in the press. Like, yeah, I'm totally in 9 months of shooting as a ghost. You know, it's like, I don't know if they're going to actually kill him the way he dies in the actual comic books. Spoilers, if you don't read comics, he dies in one of them and he comes back. So it's not like
Crossbones kills him.
But he went undercover. So it's like they could reveal that in a way where it's like, because of the accords and the way they're dealing with stuff, maybe he's like, I don't want to wear I don't want to be Captain America anymore. I'm going to be some other, you know, I'm going to go undercover or something. That could be a form of the way they do his death. So he could still be in Avengers, or they actually do kill him. He's not in Avengers Infinity War Part 1. He's in Avengers Infinity War Part 2, and they use like the time gem of Doctor Strange and go back to World War II, and then you see a younger Captain America, and they team up. I don't know what the hell I'm talking about.
My head hurts, but I'm intrigued.
No. Who knows? But I think they're going to kill him. So.
All right. What's next?
Todd McGorry writes, which superhero would you want as a wife? I'd want Mystique because she can change into different women.
Oh, man.
Yeah, tell her, by the way, make sure you let her know that. Tell her, you know what I love about you, honey? Right. You can become all those other women
You don't have to be you. You don't have to be you, the one I hate. Be the other people that I fantasize about.
Yeah, like every night, she just wants to be herself. She's like, hey, you want some blue mutant sex? Yeah. He's like, I was kind of thinking about all the cast of Friends at the same time.
Or Gamora, green. Why does it have to be blue?
So I... Oh, man. And you know, look, anything's on the table here. You know, I'm not saying I'm not going to pick a dude. I got to think about it for a minute, but I'm not saying, you know, I don't know.
Boy, Rogue, Storm. Storm would be rough because she's just absorbing you the whole time.
Yeah.
So that would be a little weird. Storm with the mohawk, definitely. I don't want to be like, you know, I don't want to take Reed Richards' woman, but I'm taking Sue Storm if that's on the table.
This is a little bit more obscure, but I first got introduced to her because she was tagging around with Cable a lot, Domino. I always had a little geek crush on Domino.
Getting even more obscure, that bald woman, Moondragon. See, Moondragon.
I'm going She-Hulk if she's played by Brigitte Nielsen in 1987. I would also go with either Jubilee or Psylocke. Like, I want somebody who's a mutant who has some powers, but I don't want to go with like a Wonder Woman, because then it's like constantly, how am I going to win an argument against Wonder Woman? Yeah. She's the most powerful person in the universe. I have to take the trash out literally every day.
And the last one of truth, then you have to totally tell the truth.
Yeah.
You're right. I'm wrong.
Save the universe.
Were you thinking about me during our intimate times last night? Damn it!
Yeah. Mystique!
Mystique! That was Mystique.
let me pose the question to Ashley, since she picks this question out.
Yeah.
But I'll let you go on the male side. If you had the opportunity to marry one superhero, who would it be?
Well, she can take a female.
I can take the female side if I want.
Yeah.
I will definitely have to go with a more generic Superman, because he's gorgeous and he flies everywhere, and I'm super lazy, so he could just like pick me up and I wouldn't have to walk anywhere. He could just fly me everywhere.
Batman's like, I have a private jet. It's like, it's not the same thing.
I gotta go to the airport, go through TSA. All right, what's next?
RVK Movies writes, what Adult Swim cartoon would work best as a live action movie?
Ooh.
Adult Swim.
They tried Aqua Teen Hunger Force.
Well, they didn't do it as a live action.
That's true.
So
yeah.
Live action, that would that's be completely right. Right. Yeah. Insane.
That would be odd.
Contact the Henson Company. I would say, you know, my show Metalocalypse would be great as a live action show. Get Murderface to be played by Luis Guzman. There's a whole bunch of people. My dream cast of Metalocalypse. You can contact me and I'll tell you. But I would say any number of them would be. I mean, Children's Hospital is already live action.
I was
going to
say,
action.
Can I take one that's already live action like that? But an Aqua Teen Hunger Force movie that is done live action, but obviously would have a lot of CGI in there too. That's kind of intriguing to me.
Yeah, what about a live action? I'll go a spinoff of Aqua Teen. Maybe you know where I'm going with this. The main characters would be CGI, but the rest of the Moonanites. I would see a live-action Moonanites movie in a heartbeat. They were my favorite things about the Aqua Teen Hunger Force. I would love it.
Any number of the weirdo characters from Aqua Teen. I would say even Space Ghost Coast to Coast. Just do a Space Ghost movie, but have that humor. I know that irritate a lot of the people who are like, Space Ghost from the 60s, where he's flying around with the ape and little monkey.
No, Coast to Coast.
No, keep it a comedy. Make it Coast to Coast. Do a 90-minute thing where the Cartoon Network and Adult Swim threw Space Ghost out. They're like, get out of here. No one watches your show anymore. It's him homeless, and it's just him trying to cope for 90 minutes.
Yeah, something I would totally go for that I don't know that you can do it live action, but is just because they could go more long form with each one of the sketches would be a Robot Chicken, like a more like when Robot Chicken did Star Wars before Family Guy did Star Wars, it was some really, really brilliant stuff in there. Something like that would be great too.
Oh, wait, what, you know, when you could do live action fairly easy enough, what was that one? Under the Sea, the
Sea Lab 2021.
Sea Lab, yes, one you could probably do. That would be so. What you do is you get the Will Ferrell, Steve Carell, you get that crew together to do that sort of movie. That could be fun.
Squidbillies too. Squidbillies is one that you would have to do CGI a little bit too with some of the characters, but you also have some humans in there that I think would be a fun mix.
And speaking of superhero, like Venture Brothers, that's going into its sixth season right now. Yeah. That's a pretty easy one.
What I've learned in this conversation is that we watch a lot of Cartoon Network.
Yeah. All right, let's take a couple more.
My Opinions writes, I wanted to ask, do you think it's a curse or blessing to not hate most movies, be able to watch any of them?
That's a blessing when you can do that. I mean, look, like even in the worst of movies, well, maybe I shouldn't say any, but we talk all the time about how movies are subjective, and that's the most beautiful thing about them. There's something in a movie that will affect everybody a little bit differently. And every movie, no matter how bad it is, was somebody's passion project. Somebody was passionate about that movie, whether it was the director or the writer or one of the producers or somebody, and they put a lot of themselves into it. And because of that, if you're somebody who can enjoy them even when they're terrible, I would define that as a blessing. I really would. What about you, Mark?
Especially when you're going to have fun just going to the movies and getting excited about something. You should. Everything you can love, you should. Earth needs more love, everybody. There's a dark side of humanity that's going to try to tear you down, especially when you're online and say, oh, I can't believe you would love something like Fantastic Four or something like Ride Along 2. If you like those movies, God, that's awesome. You should like as much as you possibly can.
The Earth needs more love. I hear that's Robert De Niro's catchphrase now. Anyway, Schnapp.
I was going to say, there's always somebody passionate about just trying to get the job done. They're like, oh, this movie's so horrible. I must edit it as quickly as possible just to get it out of my life. I'm passionate about trying to finish it. So, yeah, once in a while you get a couple of stinkers. But for the most part, movie going is incredibly fun. I look forward to seeing films. It's a great thing. And if you have that passion, you should never feel weird about it. That's, you're lucky.
So. Yeah, and Mystique, honey, I need more love. And I need it from all four of the Golden Girls tonight. Can we please get kinky?
All right, what's next?
Alexander Mulari writes, what are your thoughts on people leaving their trash in the theaters after the movie, hoping for a campier rant?
You're not going to get one from me. I mean, on it, look, this is not like I'm out in public and throwing things on the road, say, oh, somebody will clean up. But no, you pay a lot of money for your movie ticket. And if you finish your popcorn, you put it down, you don't do this or whatever, you put your popcorn down, you leave the theater, they have staff that it's their job to come through and clean it up. Me personally, I do take all my trash out, mm-hmm. and I throw it out when I go. And if you think of it, great. But if you forget about it, I wouldn't lose any sleep over it. I do have a problem with people who just make a freaking mess and don't even bother to try to, like, popcorn spilled all over the place, like, whatever. But for the most part, I really don't have a problem with it, so no rant from me on that.
Yeah, there's no rant. I mean, if you just paid $17 to see a movie and you're walking through like sticky floor and there's popcorn all over the place, then you complain to the people who are running that theater because they're supposed to be cleaning that theater after every screening. There's people. I used to be an usher. You'd go through and rock through every aisle and get all the popcorn, sweep up the place, because that's just what you would expect anyone to do in a theater. You're going out. That's etiquette. That's just how it should be. So.
You littering sons of bitches. Let me give you a piece of my mind. I actually don't mind it that much because I've been so busy for the last 2 hours yelling at anybody who has the rocks to take out a cell phone that I'm so tired. I don't care if you take your own trash out or not, particularly because I used to work at a movie theater. And one of the better jobs there is actually going into the theater afterwards and cleaning up, because there's so many worse jobs you can do at a movie theater, like dealing with people or being at concession stands, that if I'm just in the dark room by myself sweeping up stuff, that's like my moment of zen. In my otherwise not ideal existence of being an usher or a concessions person at a movie theater.
But let me bring up, as an usher as well, remember you would always be able to watch the trailers. Sometimes I remember, like, you know, going in and just watching the middle of a scene of a movie that I loved, I'd see it like 8 times.
I saw Escape from LA like 10 times.
All right, okay, you two degenerates. Let me time for some honesty here, okay?
Right,
time for, I'm asking you to put your hearts out there on the table,
right.
Expose your darkest thing for everybody to see. Be honest with me. How many times, greater or lower than the number 3, did you guys eat something you saw left over in the movie theater? Be it a half chocolate bar, a half carton of popcorn. Come on now. Come on. It's all family and friends here.
This year?
As guys who worked in the theaters.
Well, I got to be honest, like when I was an usher, this was like 20 years ago. One of the most fun parts for me was like, sometimes they pop the popcorn right there in front of you, and sometimes they pop it the night before and they have it upstairs. So I would work at a theater where we'd go through tons of popcorn and they didn't have a popper downstairs. So you'd go upstairs. I'd be like, pop that son, drawing stuff. That was the most, and I'd eat so much popcorn while it's fresh, just popping off. But when I'd clean the theaters, I would not eat that popcorn. I just wouldn't. It was like, because why? It's free. For me, it was like, it's free anyway. I have like, it was as much popcorn and candy as I wanted, fresh.
Well,
not unopened. So
half
I would
eat nachos and cheese.
Nope, no way. It's garbage.
But it was utopian society for me for like a month, and then the theater realized they weren't employing this svelte, you know, ripped Ellis. They were employing chubby Ellis, and that guy loves to eat popcorn and candy. So after a while, what happened was I never did popcorn. Okay, if it was chocolate candy, I wouldn't touch it because chocolate melts and gets disgusting. If it's like Sour Patch Kids, I might have a bite of those. But the other thing I would do is they wouldn't let us as employees have courtesy cups anymore. So, and they did inventory on the cups. So occasionally I'd go in there, I'd see a cup, I'd wash it out really, really good. And then I would enjoy myself a nice Diet Coke on a break. And I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I washed the cup, guys. I washed the cup.
The Mark Ellis version of washing it real good.
As long as my germs are beating up the other germs, I don't see a problem.
And
with that.
Of the 6,000 drinks that you had, that was literally like 3 cents that you took away from the company, because soda and popcorn cost nothing.
Let's do one last one. What the hell?
One last one. All right. Gabriel writes, here's a tough question. What's your favorite movie?
Should I start with you?
I always say this. I don't have a favorite movie. I have a series of movies that I love to watch repeatedly, and it changes all the time. So I'll just, if you want to say one of my favorite movies, is Blade Runner.
Very nice. I'm going to take Star Wars off the table here because that's my obvious answer. Star Wars is far and away my favorite movie series. Nothing else comes close. After that, it gets real competitive, but the answer is going to be, as much as I love Animal House and Monty Python and the Holy Grail, Jaws. The first Jaws is my favorite non-Star Wars movie.
I mean, mine's obvious. I count them all as ones. The original Star Wars trilogy.
If I take that away from you.
If you take that away from me, depending on the day, it's usually one of the following answers. It's either one of the Godfathers, Shawshank Redemption, or Lawrence of Arabia. So it's in there, yeah. So those jockey for position now and again, but usually right there at the top.
I'll give you another one. One of my other favorites, Young Frankenstein.
Yeah,
I have like certain ones that I will watch once a year, and they always make me
great
feel great.
Knockers.
Yeah, that's right. How
would you answer that, Ashley? What would
be basically the exact opposite of you guys. My two favorites. I have two favorite movies: Mean Girls and Saw. My two favorite movies.
I love Mean Girls.
Love Mean Girls.
Honestly, I often talk about how in Spaceballs, like the single funniest moment ever in a movie is Now Lone Star You See the Evil Always Triumph Because Good Is Dumb. I always talk about that. But in my top five, always has been and always will be, was She Doesn't Even Go Here.
She Doesn't Even Go Here!
That is one of the all-time funniest single moments in a movie ever. If you haven't seen Mean Girls, watch it. Just wait for that line.
Here's two more. Ravenous is another one. I could watch that all the time. And a new one introduced to me by Holly is With Nail and I. So since I started watching it about 6 years ago, it's just check it out, With Nail and I. It's incredible.
I don't even think I want to say it. All right. Well, that'll do it for us, guys, for this installment, this Monday edition of Collider Movie Talk. Thank you so much for joining us. Listen, don't forget, lots of great films are playing at our friends over at AMC Theaters. Head on over to www.amctheaters.com for all of your theater, showtime, and, of course, your movie ticket information. Make sure you subscribe to this YouTube channel. Keep up to date on everything we got going on. Make sure you bookmark our website, collider.com. Keep you up to date on everything going on in the world of entertainment, television, movies, you name it. The writers over there keep you up to date with it, so make sure you bookmark that site. And I want to thank the people sitting at the table with me. First of all, sitting over here to my left, Mr. John Schnepp. Schnepp, where can people find you online?
You guys can follow me on Twitter, Instagram, just at John Schnepp, and you can find my film, The Death of Superman Lives, What Happened, by going to tdoslwh.com. Thanks.
Sitting over here on my right, Mr. Mark Ellis. Mark, where can people find you?
At Mark Ellis Live on all the social media outlets, and a huge steaming pile of thanks to everybody in Nashville who made it out to Zanies in the cold, the Revenant-like conditions, to see me do stand-up this weekend. Thursday and Friday of this week, I'll be in Indianapolis. Tweet me for showtimes.
And, of course, our lovely host today, the most recent Robert De Niro girlfriend, Miss Ashley Mova. Ashley, where can people find you?
I'm 18. You guys can find me on Twitter and on Instagram, at Ashley Mova. Happy Monday, guys.
And you can follow me on Facebook and on Twitter, simply at John Campy. And, by the way, guys, keep your eyes open for my new novel, The Pride, will be coming out here very shortly. I'm going to be making an announcement very, very soon. Special thanks to Jonathan and, of course, Dennis behind the controls. And thank you to you guys for joining us. Listen, don't forget, the most important part of the show is not what this table of idiots has to say. It's what you have to say. Jump down into the comments section. Leave your thoughts on any or all the topics that we discussed here today. So that'll do it for us, guys. My name is John Campion for Collider Video. And until next time, bye-bye.
Yeah, spring break.
Hey, guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.